Good morning. Good morning. I welcome you on this fifth Sunday of Easter. Always good to see you all, and we welcome those who may be worshiping with us for the first time, either here in the sanctuary or online. As we share a few announcements, we invite all those seated on the inside aisles to sign the friendship pads and to pass them along. And as always, we encourage you to greet one another warmly. And we also invite you after the service to join us in Fellowship Hall for coffee and conversation. The altar flowers this morning are given by Dick Ham. Let's see. This fits so well with the sermon this morning.
Sounds good.
Oh. Of course. There isn't a picture. That's why you can't find it. Oh, this fits so well with the sermon this morning. But the altar flowers this morning are given by Dick Ham to remember his father, Robert, and in loving memory of his wife, Jolene. And you'll notice things are a little different up here this morning and at various places around the sanctuary, the church, and that is because the Ipswich River Community Chorus is holding their concerts here in our sanctuary this week. They had their first one last night. There is another one at 4:00. And if you want to hear a chorus with 70 voices, the whole front, all singers, that is at 4:00, and I believe there are tickets available at the door. And I'm going to call upon our Minister of Discipleship.
Good morning.
Good morning.
I only have one announcement today. It's a big, important one. I need a few friends to join me. So when I invite you up, come on up. Celeste, Tyler Davidson, Abby DiCarlo, Julia Connolly, and Abby Thorne. I learned years ago we also need a recycling bin for this announcement. So, some of you have seen me do this before, several times, and even if you haven't, what do you think is in there? A Bible. What does the wrapping paper look like? What color is it? It's brown. The brown paper reminds us that this is a very old book, a book of 30 centuries. It's difficult even to imagine that many centuries. Are any of you that old? No. Is Reverend Hughes that old? No. Some parts were written more than 1,000 years before Jesus was even born. Some of the stories are so old, they were told long before people knew how to write. This is an ancient, sacred book of our faith. You may carefully remove the brown paper and put it right into the recycling bin. You can rip it. Just try not to rip the layer below it. Now, what does the wrapping paper look like? Maps. These maps are created with roads, highways, rivers, and oceans. They give us directions on how to get somewhere. It may be Boston or California or Florida. The Bible gives us directions on how to live our lives. It teaches us how to be good people and make God proud. Go ahead and carefully remove the maps. I I think this is the gentlest Bible Sunday group we've ever had.
I was just thinking that.
Are you this careful at Christmas time? Oh, so you know how special these gifts are then, don't you? You can rip it. It's okay. What do you see on the wrapping paper now? Comics. The Bible is filled with stories, some of the best stories in the world. You have been learning some of them in your Sunday school classes, but now you can read them for yourselves. There are adventure stories and miracle stories, stories of heroes and stories of villains. You will wonder, what did this story mean to the very first people who heard it? Why did they think this story was so important that it must be written down? What do these stories mean for my life? Carefully remove the comic book pages. Just the comic book layer, just the comic book layer. What color is underneath the comic book layer? White. The white layer stands for light. It's okay. This Bible is a gift from God. Reading the Bible is our way of finding out what God has in store for God's people. We get to know more about what the Bible says as we study our special lessons during Sunday school. Go ahead and remove the layer of paper. The Bibles we give out this morning are a gift from your church family. We hope you will read through your Bible and enjoy it. Ask your parents, your pastors, or your teachers any questions that you might have about your Bible and the stories you read. We also have cases for each of you, so you can bring your Bibles back and forth. And your parents chose their favorite inspirational scriptures for you. There are also scriptures from Pastor Hughes and myself and one of your Sunday school teachers. And they have these ribbons, so you can put several ribbons in several pages to keep your place in your Bible. Let us pray. Good and gracious God, we give you thanks for this day and for your miraculous word, for these books that teach us how to follow you. We thank you especially for today for these children. We ask that you watch over them, that you guide them, and that you lead them on the path that you have set for them all the days of their lives. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Thank you. Congratulations.
I know we have a couple of announcements. Janet Nikosha has one for outreach, I believe, so.
Hi, everybody.
Hey.
So May is our Brown Bag for Hunger North Reading Food Pantry collection. So you can bring items to the church. I'll tell you what we're our focus on this year, and it's pretty much the same as we've done last year, is juice boxes and snacks for kids that go to camp. A lot of kids that are utilize the food pantry also receive free lunch, but that doesn't happen in the summer. So if kids are going to camp, they needs for stuff for children. So in that vein, it would be granola bars, things that would go on with in snacks, think of Cheez-Its, that kind of stuff, and juice boxes. They're also mentioning that they do need solid white tuna. So you can put things in the bin right in the back of the church. We'll have a bin out by the outreach bulletin board, and members of the food pantry will be just sort of emptying them during the month, so we don't have to have it all pile up and overflow, because I'm sure you guys are super generous and are every year. So thank you very much.
Also going to call on Nancy Thorne, who has an announcement on behalf of Faith Circle.
Our church spring rummage sale run by Faith Circle is over and was very successful. Thank you for everyone for your generous donations. We want to especially thank the people who came to break down the tables and bag up the remaining items which were distributed to various places. It's always amazing to see that half an hour after the sale is over, Fellowship Hall is completely empty. Many hands do quick work. And one more thing, most items we sell are for $5 or less, plus Saturday all day is a grocery bag that you can stuff as much as you want for $5. So it's always a pleasant surprise to hear how much we make. So this sale, we brought in $1,806 for the church. Thank you.
And I believe that is the highest you've ever raised. I think it is. Yep. Yeah. Just a couple of additional announcements. The last hymn this morning will be new, and it was chosen because it fits with the sermon. Marsha's going to play it. When we get to the end of the service, the choir will sing it through first, and then we'll all join them on the first verse a second time. Thank you, Marsha. The song is Easter Jubilation. And then our final announcement also has to do with Marsha Cutlip. And I am very pleased this morning to share with you that the council at its meeting this past week removed the interim title from her position. She is now our permanent music director. If there are no other announcements, then let us draw near to God's throne of grace, that we might rejoice and be glad in the love that is from everlasting to everlasting. Also, we forgot to announce Pastor Gail will not be here for the service. She is going with the confirmation class to attend the service this morning at Aldersgate United Methodist Church. Please join me in the call to worship. Let us come and roll away the stones of doubt and take the lid off our joy. If you want, bounce a few alleluias off the walls. And butterflies out of cocoons.
Celebrate the risen Christ who puts hope into your steps.
And joy in our souls.
And peace in our hearts.
And a song on our lips. Please join me in the prayer of invocation. God of blessings, great and small, the psalmist calls us to make a joyful noise unto you. So come to us now and sweep away the attitude that says that we need to worship you with staid and stoic hearts. Help us to sing and dance and be merry as your servant David was when he brought the Ark of the Covenant into the holy city. This we ask as faithful disciples of our glorious Savior, Jesus Christ, who taught us to pray together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Ghost, as it was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be. Please be seated. Good people, we are all received into the body of Christ through the sacrament of baptism. Today we have three disciples who have found nurture and support in the midst of this family of Christ. They have been led by the Spirit to claim in our presence their covenantal relationship with Christ and the members of this household of faith. They are here for service to Jesus Christ using the gifts which the Holy Spirit bestows. At this time, I would like to call upon our deacon, Lauren McMullen, to come forward.
Good morning.
No, not yet. I'll cue you.
Okay, sorry.
I invite to come forward those who will be received this morning as their names are called. Joining by letter of transfer from the Congregational Church in Westminster, Massachusetts, are Stephen and Carolyn Hemmen. And joining by affirmation of faith, Maxwell Murphy. Jesus said, I am the vine, and you are the branches. Anyone who abides in me and I in that person is the one who bears much fruit. If you abide in me and my words abide in you, ask what you will, and it shall be done for you. If you keep my commandments, you will abide in my love. These things I have spoken to you, that my joy may be in you and your joy may be complete. I ask you these questions. Do you desire to affirm your baptism into the faith and family of Jesus Christ?
I do.
Do you profess Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior?
I do.
Do you promise by the grace of God to be Christ's disciples, to follow in the way of our Savior, to resist oppression and evil, to show love and justice, and to witness to the work and word of Jesus Christ as best you are able?
I do.
Do you promise according to the grace given you to grow in the Christian faith and to be a faithful member of the Church of Jesus Christ by celebrating Christ's presence and furthering Christ's mission in all the world? I would like to invite our deacon to lead us in owning the covenant.
I invite the members of the Union Congregational Church who are able to please stand and join me in owning the church covenant. We covenant with the Lord and one another
and bind ourselves in the presence of God to walk together in all his ways, according as he is pleased to reveal himself unto us in his blessed word of truth.
The congregation may be seated. Let us give thanks. Almighty and everlasting God, may your hand be ever over your servants who have covenanted with us this day. May your spirit of courage and compassion be with them always. So lead us all in the knowledge and obedience to your word, that we may serve you in this life and dwell with you in the life to come. This we ask in the name of our Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. Amen. And now on behalf of the congregation, I extend to you the right hand of fellowship and welcome you into our midst. And I will also say we have certificates of membership for you, which I left on my desk in my office. And you're not going to believe how well that fits with the sermon this morning. God bless. Thank you.
Won't you let me be your servant? Let me be as Christ to you. Pray that I may have the grace to let you be my servant too. We are pilgrims on a journey. We are travelers on the road. We are here to help each other go the
Please be seated. Good people, in a world that is full of troubles and sorrows, we have so many reasons to be thankful and be glad. We have been called to be a voice of peace and hope and reconciliation. So let us accept that call as we come now to God's altar with our tithes and our offerings. Please join me in the prayer of dedication.
God of empty tomb and resurrection love, we give you thanks and praise for all of the blessings that fill our hearts with the laughter and joy that make life worth living. We also come to your altar with this offering, knowing that there are those who have no song in their heart. Help us to, at all times, be an Easter people who long to do whatever we can to transform tears of sorrow into tasting tears. This we promise and pray in the name of our risen Savior. Amen. Before I invite all of the children to come forward, I would like to invite the Jubilee Children's Choir to come forward. Done. I'm going to invite all of the boys and girls to please join me. Good morning. It's so good to see you all today. And
Congratulations to our third graders who received their Bibles this morning. And I want to talk to you about hidden talents. And hidden talents are something that maybe we can do that we didn't even know we could do, or something that we can do that maybe other people didn't know we could do. And I got thinking about some of my hidden talents, and one that I didn't know I could do was I didn't know that I could do crafts. And I do them, it doesn't come natural. I have to think everything through, but I made these gnomes and they light up at night. And that's one hidden talent. I also have another hidden talent. Do you know that I can wiggle my nose like a bunny rabbit? It's true. Yeah. Another hidden talent that I have is I can actually make my eyeballs go in different directions, but I'm not going to show you that because it freaks some people out. So you're just going to have to take my word for it. And then I also have this hidden talent, and it took me a little while. I haven't done it in a lot of years, and I'm out of practice, but this is another hidden talent that I have. In my younger years, I actually did a whole children's message while standing on my head. And the point was that when we follow Jesus, he challenges us to look at things differently. And I'm not that young anymore, so that will have to suffice. And if I had more time, I would have been able to stay up on my head much longer. But those are silly things, aren't they, that I can do? I mean, some people would say, doesn't really serve a purpose, just makes people laugh and go, ooh, isn't that interesting? And it got me thinking, the Apostle Paul, who followed Jesus and spread the word about Jesus, he wrote in one of his letters that we are called to be fools for Jesus. I see some funny looks there, fools for Jesus. And what he means is that sometimes when we follow Jesus, we have to do something that other people are gonna think is foolish. For example, if somebody does something bad and you don't like it, you forgive them. And some people might say, that's foolish, you don't get forgive someone, you make them beg for forgiveness, and then maybe you forgive them. Or maybe there's someone at school that really doesn't have any friends, and you go over and you spend some time with that person, and you talk to that person, and others might think, that's kind of foolish, that person's different. But Jesus wants you to love that person. And so when we follow Jesus, sometimes we have to be a fool for him. We're going to have to do something that other people think is foolish. And I believe that my friend Julia is going to do the prayer this morning.
Dear God, thank you for all the wonder blessings that make us smile and fill our hearts with joy. Help us not to take ourselves too seriously and to be fools who only worry about what Jesus wants us to do. Amen.
Thank you. Go ahead. Yep, go ahead. Don't forget to get the basket too, okay?
Say, I know that he is living.
Please be seated. Please join me in the responsive call to prayer. Draw near to God, and God will draw near to you. Good people, let us enter into this time of stillness that we might be one with our God. My friends, are there prayers that you would like to lift up to the Lord this morning? Yes, Leanne.
I just have two prayers. I'd like to pray for a student of mine who's very sick.
Oh.
Juliet.
Juliet. We let us lift up in prayer Juliet, who is one of Leanne's students and is quite ill. We ask God's healing to be upon her. Lord, in your goodness.
And I'd like to pray for my friend Ernestine, who's having back surgery, that it would be successful.
And so we also lift up her friend Ernestine as she prepares for back surgery. We give thanks for all the miracles that modern medicine can do. Lord, in your goodness. Also lift up in prayer, and we continue to pray for Shirley Raynard's granddaughter Lisa, who is dealing with lupus, and hopefully things are a little better this week. No, I'm sorry to hear that. We certainly send her love and pray that God's presence will be all around them. Lord, in your goodness. Nancy Ferretti is now at home. She was hospitalized for COVID, and my understanding is she's doing better, and for that we give thanks. Lord, in your goodness. We continue to pray for the people of Gaza who are suffering so much, the families of the hostages, and all who live in the shadow of violence, and also our service members who are in harm's way. Lord, in your goodness, let us pray. God of all that has been and all that is yet to be, we come this day to delight in the wonder of your goodness, and to offer you all of the worries that weigh upon our hearts. Here in the peace of your sanctuary, we lift up to you all the songs and the sighs that are stirring in us. Help us to find the peace that comes from knowing that you hold tomorrow and all the days that are yet to be in the palm of your hand. So as we continue to rejoice and be glad in the miracle, yes, the miracle of the empty tomb, help us to claim our calling to be an Easter people and to let our light shine so that others may see our good deeds, our deeds of loving kindness, and give glory to you. All this we pray as disciples of the risen Christ, who has come and will come again and is with us even now. Amen. I call upon Maxwell Murphy, who will share this morning's reading from the book of 2 Samuel.
David again gathered all the chosen men of Israel, 30,000. And David arose and went with all the people who were with him from Baal Judah to bring up from there the ark of God, which is called the name of the Lord of hosts, who sits enthroned on the cherubim. And they carried the ark of God on a new cart and brought it out of the house of Abinadab, which was on the hill. And Uzzah and Ahio, the sons of Abinadab, were driving the new cart with the ark of God, and Ahio went before the ark. And David and all the house of Israel were making merry before the Lord, with songs and lyres and harps, and tambourines and castanets and cymbals. And when those who bore the ark of the Lord had gone six steps, he sacrificed an ox and a fattened animal. And David danced before the Lord with all his might. And David was wearing a linen ephod. So David and all the house of Israel brought up the ark of the Lord with shouting and with the sound of the horn. The word of the Lord.
My mistake. I didn't include the second half of the reading there. And could you go back to the previous one so I can see what verse I need to look at? 13, chapter 6, 13. As the ark of the Lord came into the city of David, Michal, the daughter of Saul, looked out of the window and saw King David leaping and dancing before the Lord, and she despised him in her heart. And they brought the ark of the Lord and set it in its place inside the tent that David had pitched for it. Again, that little miscue on my part fits so well with the sermon this morning. I also give Max credit for pronouncing all of those strange names and places correctly. Let us pray. May the words of my mouth and the meditations of our hearts upon the sacred scriptures be acceptable in your sight, O Lord, our strength and always our Redeemer. Amen. This happened about 12 years ago, and it happened right here in this sanctuary. It was one of those head-scratching moments that leave you wondering, did I miss something? It all started when Scott White, our music director at the time, pre-recorded the second half of the worship service. He did that so he could go up to Fellowship Hall and help the children learn a new song. While he was up there doing that, Tom Parker, our senior deacon at the time, was sitting over there at the organ, and he was turning the knob and pressing the play button for all of the hymns and our sung responses, and he was doing it right on cue. At the end of the service, we were all standing, ready to sing Shalom to you now. So you can imagine what the reaction was when Tom pressed the button and we heard the introduction to Joy to the world, the Lord has come. Let earth receive her King. Tom immediately turned to me with a look of horror on his face. Meanwhile, Scott White was out in Putnam Hall having a mini stroke. And the rest of us, we just erupted into unrestrained laughter. It probably wasn't the most dignified way to end the worship service, but you know what? I believe that the Lord was right here laughing with us. My guess is that King David also would have laughed with us. I say that because of what happened when King David brought the Ark of the Covenant into Jerusalem. He basically threw a great big party. And you get the feeling that there was singing and shouting and chanting and celebrating. While all of that was going on, what did David do? David stood there in the middle of the street and he danced. He danced before the Lord, but he didn't just dance before the Lord. We're told that he danced before the Lord with all of his might. Now, to picture this, it's safe to say that David was doing that after having a little bit of sacramental wine. It's also safe to say, if you read between the lines, that David wasn't exactly properly dressed. So not everyone was thrilled with David's public display of joy. One such person was Michal. She was the daughter of the previous king, King Saul. And as far as she was concerned, what David was doing, his dancing, was disrespectful to God and demeaning, yes, demeaning for someone who was supposed to be the king of Israel. So we're told that when she looked out her window and saw David dancing before the Lord, she despised him in her heart. Interesting. Two different people with two different reactions to what happened that day. David was delighted. Michal was disgusted. David was happy. Michal was horrified. But you know what? David didn't care. You can almost see Michal standing there, shaking her head and grumbling, "Are you serious?" Well, guess what? David was serious. He was absolutely serious about not taking himself too seriously. He was wrapped up in the moment of joy, and he didn't care what Michal thought about him or what he was doing. He didn't care what anyone thought about him or what he was doing. David didn't take himself too seriously. That can be a problem today, can't it? People taking themselves too seriously. That's because we live in a society where it's all about image and being important. So the temptation is always there to worry about what people are thinking, and you end up taking yourself too seriously. By the way, ministers aren't immune from doing that. In fact, ministers can, because they've been called to teach and preach and administer the sacraments, they can take themselves a little too seriously. That attitude actually led to an interesting conversation one day between a young boy and a priest. The young boy had never seen a priest before, and he was fascinated by the collar that the priest was wearing. When the priest noticed that the young boy was staring at him, he asked if something was wrong. The young boy didn't say a word. He just pointed at the collar. "Oh, that," the priest said with a smile, "that collar is actually very important, and do you know why I'm wearing it?" At that point, the young boy nodded his head and said, "Yeah, you're wearing it because it kills ticks and fleas for up to 6 months." Yes, ministers can also take themselves too seriously at times. That's why I have always been thankful for a conversation that I had many years ago when I was still in seminary. The conversation was with the pastor of the church where I was doing field ed. I was serving as a student minister. As the weeks went by, the pastor noticed that everything I did had to be just right. So one day during supervision, he asked me a question. "What would happen," he said, "if you got up in front of the congregation on Sunday morning and made a big mistake?" I replied, "Oh, that would be terrible." Reverend Coakley thought about it for a moment and then said, "Well, this Sunday, I hope you get up in front of the congregation and you fall flat on your face." My first thought was, that's not a very pastoral thing to say. But then as I thought about it, I began to realize he was doing me a big favor. He was sharing some words of wisdom with me. His point was, Even if you fall flat on your face, it's not the end of the world. The sun will still come up tomorrow, and God will love you always. Yes, David is right. Life is better when you don't take yourself too seriously. And I'm also thankful for that conversation that I had with Reverend Coakley, because it allows me to do something every year at the last Lobster Bisque Lenten Luncheon. People who've been coming for years expect it. I put on this hat. Make it even better, Maureen Daugherty, the editor of the transcript, put it in the paper this week. Thank you, Maureen. But you know what? It's okay. I just look silly. I'm very good at that sometimes. Yes, David is right. When you don't take yourself too seriously, life is better. When you follow David's example, instead of worrying what people think, you only care about what God wants you to do. When you follow David's example, when you go through the day, your only concern is doing what the Lord wants you to do, so that at the end of the day, you'll be able to know that the Lord is saying to you, well done, good and faithful servant. When you follow David's example, instead of waking up each day and groaning, good Lord, it's morning, you'll wake up each day and joyfully say, good morning, Lord. Yes, life is better when you don't take yourself too seriously. Just ask David. Just ask Ann Weems. Ann Weems has in her book, Reaching for Rainbows, a essay called Cough Drops in Church. It's a conversation between a mother and her daughter. It begins with the mother asking her daughter this question.
What do you like best about church?
I like cough drops.
I know you like cough drops, but what do you like best about church?
Well, cough drops are important to little kids like me.
Cough drops are very nice if you have a cough.
You mean if I don't have a cough, they're not nice?
Oh, I imagine you'd like them any time, but they're for a cough.
Well, I like them in church.
Cough or not?
I feel so good when I'm sitting next to you and kind of snuggling up and chewing a cough drop.
Kind of good?
One like belonging.
Belonging?
That's the way I feel about church. I belong here where the music is and where the words say that God loves me even if I'm a little kid.
Even if?
Well, I don't have a job or anything like that, but God doesn't seem to mind.
No, God doesn't seem to mind at all. In fact, I'd venture to say that God likes very much to have you in church, unemployed though you might be.
Cough drops and all?
Cough drops and all.
Good people, there you have it. A king who danced before the Lord with all of his might and cough drops in church. Life is good when you don't take yourself too seriously. So here's an idea. Why don't we end the service this morning by singing Joy to the World? Just kidding. Well, maybe not. Amen.
Thank you.
People of God, our service of worship is ended. Let us prepare to go forth wherever we may be, knowing that our God goes before us. And may the blessing of God Almighty, Creator Christ and Holy Spirit, be upon you all. Amen.